Om Shanti.
Om Shanti. Good morning and welcome to you all in this Valedictory session of the conference exclusively for the Supreme Court and High Court judges on spiritual empowerment of judiciary, the need of the hour. The topic for today's Valedictory session is Jurist Vision. So Prajapita Brahma Kumari's Ishwarya Vishwavidyalaya sister organization, Rajyoga Education and Research Foundation, has divided the entire strategy of the society into 18 groups. And a separate wing of jurists to look and have the form of rendering spiritual services to each group. The jurist wing was formed, one of among them. And we have gathered here to deliberate upon the ways and the means for the realizations of the visions for the formation of the better world. So for this program, I invite our learned speakers for this session, Reverend Dadi Hirday Mohini Ji, His Excellency Lieutenant General K.M. Sheth, Honorable Mr. Justice Ranganath Mishra Ji, Honorable Mr. Justice B. Bikshapati Ji, Honorable Mr. Justice V. Ishwarya, Honorable Justice M.S. Shah, B.K. Ramesh N. Shah, Geeta Behen, Jay Prakash Bhai, start with the program with 2 minutes meditation in the remembrance of the Supreme Father Shiva. I request BK sisters to welcome the honorable guests on the dais with flowers and badges. Honorable Justice Ranganath Mishra Ji, His Excellency Mrs. K.M. Sheth, His Excellency Lieutenant General K.M. Sheth, Justice M.S. Shah, Honorable Justice Bikshapati Ji, Honorable Justice Aishwarya, program. Thank you. would request Honorable Mr. Justice Ranganath Mishra ji, the former Chief Justice of India, to open the topic and give us his valuable ideas and thoughts on the topic Jurist Vision for a Better World. Om Shanti.
Om Shanti. Rajyapal ji, brethren, there was a time when I knew all the judges of all the high courts, but being away from the brotherhood, I am not in a position to recognize everyone, but I assume that most of you in the gathering here this morning are from the fraternity. It's a well thought of and planned meet which has brought us all together. This institution which has organized this meet has been trying its best to plan a better order of human existence on Mother Earth. Every aspect which requires attention is sometimes given focus. And round the year, you come across topics which are man-making, social building up process, and bring men together for a common purpose of happy coexistence. Most of you have by now, if you had not had it earlier, got a view of the purpose of this institution, the working of it, the methodology adopted, and the result achieved. I have not to refer to those this morning. Judiciary is an old institution in society. In fact, it's one of the oldest. So far as India is concerned, if you refer to our literature, you would find for thousands of years, society in its ordering of life has been planning with reference to the judicial system. We had in our past judges, lawyers, enforcers, and reviewers also. Reviewers were not people of the modern type. They were themselves ascetics, people with learning, people with dedication, people with capacity, who were reviewing the societal relationship by trying to find out if any modification, any improvement was necessary, any new course had to be adopted. And this was the career of capable people all their life devoted to this system. Terms available in Sanskrit literature indicate the parameter of the judicial system prevalent in the past. The references to the lawgivers who have in their Sanghitas and in their writings have referred to the process are clearly indicative of the fact that societal focus was from the curative angle examining the procedure, the resultant situation, and bring about improvements. In the history of the judicial system in India, all of you are our brethren, that we had from time to time introduced developed processes to achieve the purpose. When the Mughals came in, when the British was followed up, our judicial system was affected. And a system that was allowed to grow on a background or on a root which was different did not really very much materialize. In independent India, for the last 50 years and odd, we have been experimenting without much of success, a system that can be adopted. We have allowed the prevailing system when we became independent in vogue to continue. A system which may not be very convenient, may not be very congenial or suitable, but that is the one that has been in the field. My own impression is we have introduced certain experiments which have affected the judicial system. The core of it, the backbone of it, has been mauled, and it would take time to set it right. We inherited a system from the British time when we were not independent from that time, and we wanted it to be modified as and when necessary. To accept one system without modification as in a whole way is one matter. To accept it with modifications from time to time as appeared necessary is a very different matter. We have affected the system on account of undue interference. The system that was taken from the Britishers, who had experimented it for about 250 to 300 years, if taken as whole hog adaptation, would have been much better than tinkering, which we did. The judges, our number was about 500 when I was Chief Justice. The number has increased, is about 600 and odd now. By interpreting the judgment and the language of the provisions of the Constitution, we decided that the appointments to the superior courts should be taken over by the judges themselves. I remember a few days after the 9-judge bench decided the main matter, a couple of American Supreme Court judges had visited Delhi. Two of them were guests of the Human Rights Commission, which I was presiding over. The same judges were also invited in the evening to the Supreme Court. Many of the judges who attended the lunchtime engagement heard the two American judges saying that, well, you have misappropriated power. They were addressing or referring to the Supreme Court judges. In the evening, that was repeated also. The same judges again said that, well, this is the only institution which makes appointment to itself. We have not come across any institution in the world where the appointment is done by itself to onto itself. We are aware of the position that Article 124(2) of the Constitution refers to consultation. That the appointing authority or appointment making authority is the president. The president has been authorized by the Constitution in that article to consult judges of the High Court and judges of the Supreme Court for appointing Supreme Court judges. The judgment rendered by the Supreme Court takes away the High Court as a consultative forum or facility and limits the consultation to 4 judges, senior most judges of the Supreme Court. Before this judgment, consultations we were making, no doubt about it. I filled up 6 vacancies in the Supreme Court. In each case, I consulted almost everyone. I do not understand how consultation and concurrence can stand together, pari materia. Consultation means the decision-making is somebody else's. And you gather opinion, formulate your needs and the requirements, and accordingly go ahead to complete the process. If it is concurrence, you are really consulting and somebody else has to concur and lead to it, you have no role to play. The president, as the executive head, acts on the advice of the Council of Ministers. Therefore, the Council of Ministers, under the Constitution as it is or as it was being worked out to be, left the matter for a free consultation. We have taken away the scope of consultation from High Court judges and all other judges of the Supreme Court to a limited few. 2 things. If appointments were better, if the mechanism was working perfectly, we had no problem. Experience shows over the years that it has not come to that. Vacancies were not being filled up by the executive was the allegation. I was handling that matter which was brought to the Supreme Court by the Advocates on Record Association of the Supreme Court, that judges were not being appointed. Over about 15 to 16 months, we controlled this and insisted upon the executive authority to make the appointments. When we found that the appointments were reduced, the vacancies were reduced and the number came to a few and the vacancies had occurred within about 2 to 3 months from the time when we were hearing the matter, we thought it should be now left to the executive to handle. We only gave a direction for that purpose. And the matter was referred to a larger bench of 9 judges to find out what happened to primacy of the Chief Justice and if that can really be restored in the matter. I am not criticizing anyone. The purpose of a gathering of this type is not criticism. We are trying to see rationality, reasoning, and we are also trying to work out whether there is something better than what is in hand or what is in the practice or process now. It is from that angle. Not because you are a group of retired judges or a group of sitting judges, it's not that attitude. It's an institution which has sustained society, and it's an institution without which society cannot run. So it's an indispensable unit of society, and peace in society, tranquility in society, happiness in society have certainly something to do with an effective working process of the judicial system. Our concern with the judicial system being perfect is on account of the fact that if that is defect, if that does not serve the purpose, ultimately you will not get peace in society. Everybody knows that the judiciary ultimately is a powerful wing. And in a democracy like ours, the judiciary has a major role to play in social existence and social functioning. It's on that account that the common man becomes interested in how the judiciary functions and looks forward without success for an accountability from the system. The judiciary today doesn't have a realization, perhaps, that it is accountable. There is no institution in society which exercises social authority which can go without accountability. In fact, our constitution has been so framed that you have three wings, and each wing is supposed to be functioning as an autonomous unit. But our system is careful. The constitution makers have taken great pains to ensure that there is an interlinking, and no branch or no wing out of the three can function independently of the two others. Lawmaking power is given to Parliament. The executive has also been given power to make laws. That is how ordinances are made. An ordinance made is as strong, as effective, and as capable as any other legislated law. We have the judiciary. Judiciary has been given the power of interpretation. A word said in Parliament or by law in Parliament, made by Parliament, can take a very different meaning from what exactly has been given in the Constitution. The nine-judge bench judgment is actually an illustration of that. The Constitution says one way, interpretation has taken it to some other way, and has brought about a situation which doesn't fit into the language, English language, and these two words in English language have definite meaning. And therefore, that process, it is very difficult to understand how could it be fitted in. But as I repeat, our gathering here and the discussion is not aimed at criticism of the Supreme Court. We have to call out something which will help us to develop, take. The problem that has been facing our judiciary is arrears. We have 30-year or 32-year arrear cases in good number. We have some high courts where the intake is more than the disposal, and therefore, as time passes, the load increases. There is no scope for reduction. Allahabad High Court, for instance, if you take a monthly statement of, you will find that the increase is more, the debit is less. And in a situation of that type, you must be remembering the filling up of the tank by water. So much of water comes, so much of water goes, when would the tank be filled? Is a normal arithmetical question in school. Similarly, if somebody works it out high court-wise, how will you find, how will it be disposed of? More disposal is necessary. Allahabad is a high court which has 102 probably as the sanction strength, both the places put together. I have a feeling that 40 vacancies normally continue to be there in the high court. A total of about 150 vacancies remain in all the high courts put together. There used to be a blue book issued by the Secretary of State for India before independence, which indicated, work out your refill system in this way, that one judge retires at 4 o'clock in the evening one day, and his successor enters the courtroom at 10:30 next morning. That means there is no gap. That used to be the blue book. Now the blue book principle is not working, and if known vacancies are there, somebody is retiring. All of us know long before that an event will happen, the system must be geared up and the work should be so done. The principle prevalent in the British time should work out, no vacancy at all. Vacancies of this large size create problem. Supreme Court has been keeping on indicating that, well, the number of courts should be more. Population-wise, taking 1950 as the base, we are about four times that. 25 crores has become about 100 or 104.5 crores. Litigation has increased by about 20 times. Four times population, 20 times litigation, and court strength has not very much increased. On account of that, the Supreme Court has been harping upon increase of courts. It's not working. Various reasons are being indicated or advanced as to why it's not possible to implement in the ratio the Supreme Court indicates. Supreme Court has taken into consideration the position in other countries and has worked out a number which does demand genuine consideration by the government. The other problem is transfer of judges. Judges transfer came to meet a situation which probably was not a problem. It was misread. And in 10 years, the Supreme Court has realized that transfer doesn't work. They have recalled the system of transfer after the system has received a jolt. When judges came from outside, they found that the language they were operating through is different, which they don't understand. The laws were different than what they were used to. Most of the judges are practitioners. Those who are not practitioners before appointment, they were judicial officers. They were handling the law also. So it was acquainted law and didn't require any phrase or serious rereading or application of mind. The language problem. Evidence is recorded in one language. The judge who comes from outside is not used to that language, the script. That again created problem. So therefore, then the other problem again I should indicate here is judges, once they are transferred from a distance, the weekends are lost. Because they want to keep contact with the family, they would like to go, they want the members of the family to come for a short while. And therefore, the weekend, which was the time available for applying mind at home to serious matters and get judgments ready, that again was not available. Judges are men. They have families. They have problems. And I would refer to one particular judge. Complaints came that he is not able to work on the bench because he is not able to follow the provisions that are made. I asked him, I said, what exactly is the problem in court? You are not attentive. Then he said, my wife is ill, my son is ill, so-and-so is ill, so-and-so doesn't have a school admission, and these are hunting me. My problems should be reduced. Unless my problems are reduced, my mind is not applying to the situation. I came back, I helped him out. In fact, I got his son fitted somewhere, I got his wife looked after. An operation was necessary outside India, I also managed that. But the question is, you must have a powerful manager. Out of office, I am no manager at all. And most of you must be realizing that difficulty. The question, therefore, is, don't tinker with an established process unless you really think that something is necessary to be done, and without it, you can't manage. This 10-year experiment of transferring judges has really created a mess. And the realization by the Supreme Court that it is a mess and should not be followed is itself indicative that it had been done in a hurry and without examining pros and cons of the system. On the whole, the judiciary has suffered more on account of our own indecision or not looking at the problem from the right angle than from any other institution. Of late, I don't criticize. We are not individually concerned with any particular judge. We are concerned with the malady. And we are trying to find out, as this topic for the morning, the session is, to really find out how it can work out and how we can get the best of the judicial system. That is what we are supposed to debate upon, discuss in this morning session. It's one way of valedictory, but I think the real limitations of a valedictory function let us not keep. Let us try to appreciate where exactly is the problem and what exactly has been really eating up the system. The judicial system is probably the most important one in the community, in a social order. And if the system is effective, the country's future is different. People from outside, now in this one world situation, do not come to India, do not invest in India on account of the fact that they are shaky about the judicial situation. They think if a litigation comes in the court, 25 years will be necessary, and by then business will be wound up. So therefore, we won't get into India and we won't get into this problem, because we find that the judicial system is not very effective, is not delivering judgments within reasonable time. I have talked to some of these people. They had come and told the carpet industry people from Bhadohi, from Benares. Germany had taken the lead to say that child labor is involved in it. European Council will not buy carpets from India. Indian carpet is the best by children because the fingers are pliable and small knots are available, therefore children work. Economically, it's a thing which is probably the best. The children operate it. The court had evolved a system, but last time we met these German people, they indicated to us that, well, you take a matter to litigation, 20 years. We don't sit for 20 years in Germany, nor does the European Council wait for this. We are not prepared. So country's economy, country's prosperity, country's future depends upon the efficacy of the judiciary. They are not litigants here. You don't have a pending litigation, but they're afraid that if they open up in India their business and matters are brought to court, there would be no finality in reasonable period. And therefore, it would not be convenient, it would not be economic, it would not be possible for that industry to work out with Indian industry of that group. Country's future is therefore directly associated with an efficacious judicial system. We are not considering this. We have been never told about it, but it ultimately comes to that. So, friends, what is really necessary is to evolve a system by which efficacious judicial mechanism will be possible, and you will be able to deliver decisions or judgments as quickly as possible. At one point of time, we were handling litigation through Lok Adalats. Lok Adalats, for your information, in about 7.5 years had disposed of about 7.5 million cases by settlement. Every year, minimum 1 million cases were getting disposed of, maybe more even. If that had been kept up, the speed would have increased, and maybe pendency would have been reduced reasonably. Of the 4 crores of cases that are pending in the lower courts today, about 1 crore could have been disposed of every 3 or 4 years. And normal litigation, current litigation, could be handled by one forum, this could be handled by another forum. But that, again, is not happening. First-track courts have not become effective. And one more thing. Lok Adalat had been conceived not only as concluding litigation quickly, but to bring about amity, peace among people. People came as enemies to the Lok Adalat forum, went back as friends, putting shoulder on shoulder, and they were going together with a smile. Some of you who are present and were attending Lok Adalats at that time must have seen how it brought about peace and social security, social compassion. I remember 2 communal harmony cases came to us where there had been dispute between Hindus and Muslims in Rajasthan. We settled both the cases. And when the 2 cases were settled, the community joined us in a reception without any preparation. And they offered sweets. Hundreds of sweets were brought by the local villagers, and they distributed, saying that, well, now peace will prevail. This institution where you are guests is concerned with social peace. And based upon social peace, this institution looks forward and plans a different world order. So therefore, if we are really interested that we should have peace, we should have social security, We should have appropriate adjustments in society, a new career to begin for people who live in this orderly society. What is necessary is some change in the judicial system to make it effective, to make it productive, and to make it ultimately socially tolerant and bearing. If that is not done, a time is coming when, like all other wings of the system of administration, judiciary also would be losing its capacity and hold, and would no more be serviceable in the manner in which we have been planning. Friends, therefore, what is necessary is all of us must agree to one thing, that the judiciary, like all other institutions, is accountable. Social power is exercised by the judiciary. It's no other power, it's all social power. And social power is exercised by parliament, social power is exercised by every institution in society. The law is, or the universal unfailing rule is, whoever exercises social power must be socially accountable. It's people's power, it's not the judge's power. It's not constitution's power, it's people's power. Ultimately, the people speak. And if you do not cater to the needs of the people will certainly speak. And they will speak in their language and not in your language. They will not speak in the lawyer's language. We will not be my lords thereafter. And the institution would go. So therefore, it's a big challenge which society has been now facing. And let us really mean what we are really planning. We plan that society must enforce accountability from our every institution. All of you are aware that the Indian Constitution permits a judgment of the Supreme Court to be nullified, annulled. Look at Rangachari's case, for instance, 1958 matter, that railway matter. Rangachari's case gave benefit of reservation at more than one point. The nine-judge bench, went into the matter, and they said, you have the benefit once and not more than once during your entire career. Parliament, I was present in Parliament when that was taken up. One person, one member, opposed, and all others stood up to say that we don't want discussion, we don't want anything, we want by voice vote to say that the Supreme Court decision is annulled. And the Supreme Court decision was annulled. It took 4 to 5 minutes for that nine-judge bench decision to be thrown out. I am not happy that it was thrown out, but it has happened. And the law has now been that you can have, at more than one point, reservation, the benefit. So therefore, the intertwining of these wings, these social agencies, is a matter which must be taken into account. And in thinking of making the judiciary more serviceable, making the society capable of an impact from this changed attitude, you and I, and this institution as the apex one over our head, should work out a system which would bring in peace. A system which would have a focus. A system which would ultimately show us the changed process by which the maladies in the institution today can be thrown out and the right attitude may be developed. That would be the long-term benefit from a gathering of this type. We may finish this today, this function, but I am sure the organizers have been able to generate in you a thinking process, a process by which you get motivated to plan how to bring about a change, an efficacious situation to meet the hardship, the difficulties, the social order, and the problems that society is receiving as a shock. That is the real purpose. Not a training at the moment, but opening your mind to the problem, making you conscious and stick to a thinking process, a line, to find out a remedy. The remedy cannot come by sitting here. The remedy can only come if you go out into the community, take an effective thinking participation in the process, and ultimately, whenever there is a hardship, some of you gather in your own convenient units and plan out, think. And it is only when a systematic thinking has been undertaken and ultimately we are in a position to reach the decision, one single decision ultimately to be reached, which does not require experimentation but requires enforcement in the planning, we shall certainly produce or reproduce a system which will help society to progress. Peace in society, shanti, that is the all that we really look for. And shanti can come to the community if the mental system accepts that position. Someone has very rightly observed that if you are subjected to injustice, you will never get peace. The injustice may be on a point which is very small. You have been cheated by a process very nominally, but the fact that you have been cheated will hang on to your thinking process for days together because you are not reconciling to that. That is exactly what is happening in a bigger way in life. Most of us think that we have not got our due. What is your due may be overestimated. What is your due may be the result of a wrong decision or judgment. But in your own process, you have come to the conclusion that this is my due. And since that due has not been given to you, a series of dissatisfaction take over your life process. And ultimately, you are undone. That exactly is the position of almost every Indian today. Therefore, the Indian society really requires accountability, really requires modifications, changes, which would suit the system and make our life one of peace, shanti, and not of a disgruntled existence. To that extent, I think this is an opening. To that extent, this is an opening, which is the gift of our sisters here, that they have put you together, deliberately thought of a subject which doesn't normally come to be debated, and have given you an occasion to think over and find out a molding which will recast our thinking, will bring in new solutions to our minds, and ultimately all of us will be in a position to find out something definite which can show us the way and be our answer to our problem. I don't intend to continue longer, but I welcome you all, and I pray to God that the spirit of generation within now develops. And all of you, wherever you are, will think over an answer to the question which is being posed and ultimately find out what exactly would be the thing which can bring in a system of peace and the judiciary to serve its purpose and prove its worthiness. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Honorable Mr. Justice Ranganath Mishra. He has shared his valuable thoughts before us and has given the vision for the better world which jurists can have. He has shown us that there are the three important wings, and judiciary is one of them. And judiciary now losing its importance, being accountable. And if wants to gain against the importance, then such institutions should come forward and arrange such programs whereby can give the vision for the better world. I welcome our respected Honorable Dadi Ji, Dadi Hirde Mohini Ji, and I request BK sisters to offer flower and batches to Dadiji. I would like to give the information that the retreat and conference was arranged from 30th September to 4th of October by this Jurist wing of Raj Yoga Education and Research Foundation. The first 2 days we had a spiritual retreat program whereby many spiritual topics were discussed, like who am I, what is my original qualities, what is my form, who is God, from where I have come, and etc. These all topics were discussed from 2 days, and on second evening we inaugurated the conference. His Honorable Mr. Justice A.R. Lakshmanan inaugurated the conference on second evening, and thereafter yesterday we had 2 plenary sessions and 3 workshops, and today we are conducting the valedictory session. Now I would request Honorable Mr. Justice G. Bhikshapati, judge from Andhra Pradesh High Court, to give his valuable thoughts on today's topic. Justice G. Bhikshapati.
Om Shanti. Good morning to you all. The chief guest of this function, His Excellency Lieutenant General K.M. Seth, Mrs. Seth, Her Highness Rajayogini Dadi Hruday Mohini Ji, my revered Honorable Mr. Justice Ranganath Mishra, my esteemed brothers, Justice Ishwaraya, Justice Shaw, the dedicated chairperson, Mr. Ramesh N. Shaw, National Coordinator of the Jurist Wing, Mr. Jay Prakash Sharma, in charge of legal wing of the Jurist section of BK organization, BK Lataji, and my esteemed brothers sitting in the galaxy, dedicated sisters and brothers, ladies and gentlemen. I feel myself elated to be amongst you today to speak on this occasion. I know some of the brothers have closed their eyes, but the reasons for closing their eyes can only be identify the person who also closes his eyes. The serene atmosphere, the holistic atmosphere, the divine atmosphere in this Aravalli Hills make the person the best of the lot, and the meaning in closing the eyes is that they have opened their heart and let the soul travel in this area. It doesn't mean that they are sleeping, but they are more alert than the person who is watching the program. Justice Ranganath Mishra ji has placed before you the obstacles and the problems of the judiciary. And if I could understand the situation in a proper perspective, yesterday what Dadiji was mentioning to the August gathering, that we are all Dharmarajas, But after hearing the message of His Lordship, now I can only think that we may not be Dharma Rajas, we are Karma Rajas. We are the kings of fate. Because the kings can make the law and unmake the law, but judge cannot neither make the law nor unmake the law. So therefore we may not be fit in the category of Dharma Rajas. We can only interpret the law. Sometimes we may exceed certain limits for the welfare and in the public interest, but we are completely prohibited from making the law. That is the function of another pillar of the democracy. Today, we are faced with adversarial litigation for which seats were sown by the Britishers. And a person who enters the portals of the court develops adversary system, and he continues to be adversary throughout his life. Even if he wins, loses, he always have an adversary in the system. But this makes the human being always feeling in a negative manner, as he thinks somebody is opposing me. Unless this adversarial system is changed or some other pattern is brought into effect, the litigation continues forever. It continues to be unabated even though we appoint and create number of courts and judges. It may not be able to solve this. That's why the Parliament has thought to bring the Legal Services Authorities Act, by which it is not only the judicial process which is inducted, but also beyond the judiciary the cases are being settled, like alternative dispute resolution systems, mediation, conciliation, and arbitration. But apart these functions, what is the role of the Brahma Kumaris institution in the judicial arena is one of the aspects which my Lord has already placed before you, and I would like to mention a few events which may be of some assistance to us to understand the organization. Probably in Andhra Pradesh you may be surprised to note that what the judges are not able to do being done by this NGO organization, especially the Brahma Kumaris organization, where matrimonial matters are being settled, which could not be settled before the judiciary. And in one case, one or two cases, we found that the parties are at loggerheads, wife and husband are, it is mostly done in literate category. They're highly educated, they don't compromise each other. That is an unfortunate trend in India. Once they become literate, educate, they want to exert their own right. But for whose betterment, nobody knows. But that's the principle they maintain. So therefore, these matrimonial matters, they are always at loggerheads, and the judiciary is not in a position to bring them to the normal society. And in some cases, district level, one of my district judges has asked them to go to the Brahma Kumari institution for 7 days and come again. Then he adjourned the case of divorce after 1 month. They had undergone this course and they reported that they are joining together, and the matter was closed. Thus, the parties are brought to the mainstream of the social society. But this adversarial system, the judicial system, justice according to law, it doesn't bring the people together. It always keeps the people in two compartments, either plaintiff, defendant, or appellant, respondent, petitioner, respondent. It never joins together at any point of time. So therefore, the time has come to see that the intellectuals in the galaxy and the judicial hierarchy should think of bringing a change in the system so as to transform into non-adversarial system. In that process, everybody will feel they're united. And in this system, the government is the biggest litigant everywhere throughout the India. 70% of the cases, the government is either an offensive side or defensive side. And we have seen in our High Court of Andhra Pradesh, there are about 30,000 cases are pending in land acquisition matters, land acquisition matters. You are aware the land acquisitions are taking place. And it appears the government has taken a decision wherever the enhancement is 50% more, you have to file the appeal. Automatically you have to file. So when 1 acre was taken, 2,000 rupees was fixed. They file an appeal. And in the High Court, it lies over for 15 years. And after the appeal is of the government is dismissed, government has to pay 1,20,000. Which could have been done with 2,000, they have to pay 20,000. That is where the government or the executive have to act promptly and take appropriate decision so that the judiciary may not be burdened with all this litigation where it could be easily avoided. Therefore, the holistic approach and purity approach is not only required in the judiciary, but also at all levels, at legislature, at executive level, and the judiciary level, so that the peace and happiness will prevail. And as far as Andhra Pradesh is concerned, we have also feeling shortage of officers. But at the same time, we can't help, it is not in the hands of the High Court, it is in the hands of somebody else. But we have to pull on with the burden. That's why you are making every effort to reduce dependency by various means and methods. And pendency of cases is not only attributable to the deficiency in the system and deficiency in the judges, but the people have become more right conscious. They want to exert their right, but they forget their duty consciousness. If they hold the balance between right conscious and duty conscious, the cases will not be so much. Of course, he has a right. He can enter the portals of the court for getting justice, but he should also know his duties. And without understanding the duty, exerting a right is not proper approach, even on the part of the litigant public also. Therefore, in this atmosphere, everybody should think their responsibilities as also the duties. And the judges cannot dispose of the cases. As you are aware, as my Lord has already placed before this August gathering, there's heavy pendency everywhere. And nobody can achieve 10% disposal because it's a spring. If you dispose of 100 cases, 100 cases are filed. So it's a never-ending process. But however, if you put checks and balances in the system, and that checks and balances can be brought by a holistic approach, by spiritualizing the persons, both in the official level, judicial level, and the society level. If you spiritualize, and if you make the persons holistic, there is every scope for reducing the litigation and maintaining the community harmony at all levels, in the family, in the society, at the regional level, at the state level, at the national level. And it's not that it is highly intellectual organization, but it is a very humble organization with a high ideals and holistic principles, where by means of Raja Yoga meditation, you will be able to separate the soul and body for the attainment of peace and prosperity. And that is essential in today's atmosphere for each human being. Therefore, a judge is also human. He can't be other than a human. So therefore, a good human, an organization which makes a human a good human, will also make a better judge and will be able to serve the society in a better manner and to the advantage of all the persons, including the society. Therefore, with these few words, I take leave of you, and I thank you, all the members, for having given a patient hearing. Thank you very much. Om Shanti.
Thank you very much, Honorable Mr. Justice G. Bhikshapati. He has given the visions how better world can be established by the jurists. The vision shown is that there should be holistic approach and there should be change in the attitudes. We should have a holistic and positive thoughts so that we can have a better world and change the minds of the people so that the number of litigants are demonized and hence the litigations. Hereafter, I request and invite Honorable Mr. Justice V. Ishwarya, Judge from Andhra Pradesh High Court, to share his valuable thoughts with us. Justice V. Ishwarya.
Om Shanti. Supreme land of the universe, lords of the land, today's chairperson, His Holiness Raja Yogini Dadi Hridayamoyinji, today's chief guest, His Excellency Lieutenant General K.M. Seth, former Chief Justice of India Ranganath Misraji, and Jurist Wing Chairperson P.K. Ramesh Shah, Jayaprakash brother, Geeta Behan, Lata Behan, and all brothers and sisters. The subject, today's subject is on the jurist vision of a better world. So this subject has been selected to, which is it should be a sum and substance of 4 days spiritual retreat and spiritual empowerment for the judiciary. Several these dadis, didis, brothers, the lectures have been given. Actually, the knowledge have been given by them about the soul powers and the introduction of the Supreme Being is a tremendous. It was not taught or available in any scriptures or Vedas, Smritis or Shrutis. It is there. It is also there in the Vedas, scriptures and Smritis, but in an expansion way. O vistar mein hai, jo saar mein itna achha bataya gaya hai, in a nutshell, about the powers of the spirit and the supreme soul. The powers of the supreme soul that was taught by this organization is the original quality, character of a soul itself is a peace, a peaceful entity, a blissful entity. It's a Chaitanya, Sat Chit Anand, it such a sat, our chaitanya, our anandamai. That is the quality of a self. Then whether we are in the true nature or in a nature status of a self, no. But why we are away from the our natural quality, our natural status? Why, what is the reason? Then we say, once upon a time, on this world, there is a Ramaraj. None of us have seen the Ramaraj. And Ramaraj, there is a description of the Ramaraj, not the Treta Ram, but forefathers of the Rama, there was a different world. Different, that is called a better world, Sundar Sukumai Sansar. That was vision. That was kind of the world was existing on this world. So that is called the Treta Yuga, or the Satya Yuga, or Kruta Yuga, or Paradise. So paradise was existing on this world, but we have lost the paradise. Then a Ramaraj Gaya, Ravan Raja Gaya. That means a soul conscious, we have away from the soul conscious, now we are in the body conscious, now it's a Ravan Raj. Therefore we are burning the five vices rupee Ravan every year, and we are every year we are making a taller, taller and tallest Ravana and burning, but we are not able to remove this panch vikari roop Ravan, as Dadiji was saying the other day. So that is the reason why. So whatever our forefathers have visualized excellent the constitution, but the constitution, actually whatever aims and objects the constitution has been made, so this a better world which has been visualized, or it was existing much better than what our forefathers of the constitution have visualized. So that is a better, that is kind of the world. So Brahma Kumaris wants to establish on this world with the guidance of the supreme being itself, Shiva Kalyankari. There is no teacher and our guru system is existing here. If you keenly observe the organization of the Brahma Kumaris, even Brahma Baba, who has been mediator, he never acted just like a guru, or all his disciples are disciple. He is also state, he is also student. He is learning from the supreme being, and he was giving the revelations of the supreme being. And after that also, if you see the Dadiji, one Dadiji, chief of the Dadiji, and the same qualities will have the smallest sister in the remote village also. There is no, it's how the organization, if we keenly observe, we have been observing the organization. So this itself is a kind of the better world that has been established by this organization. So whatever these constitution, central and different states are, state laws are there, this is in expansion of the expansion of the knowledge of this self, and a spiritual knowledge and the supreme being knowledge. So how many, any number of the legislations, it can't bring up a better world. Because day by day we have been making loss and loss, but we are not able to achieve the goal of it. So what is the reason of it? Because there is no change in the individual attitude. There is no change in the personal attitude. So we have forgotten the spiritual powers and the spiritualism. Therefore we are in the body consciousness. Therefore we are not able to deliver the justice, or we are not able to behave, are not able to establish a value-based society, moral or legal ethics have been missing, and each and every individual. Then how to regain? Because there is a spiritual degradation, as the former Chief Justice of India said, there is a spiritual degradation. Then how to regenerate the spirituality in own self? How to know the self is, the qualities of a self? So that is the only thing can actually, we can bring a better world. A better world can be established. Only as my brother Justice Bhikshapati has been saying, this is only one organ of the state. Judiciary is one organ of the state. Its cases, problems have been growing day by day. Any number of the courts cannot settle all the problems of this land. Therefore, this kind of the education shall be taught in all walks of life, in the students, in all organizations. As the before becoming the President of India, the present President of India, Abdul Kalam, was saying in this institution, in an organization, in a meeting like this, he was saying only there are 3 persons that can change the world. Who are those 3 persons? Primary education teacher, mother and father. These 3 persons can bring the change in this world, because the younger generation will learn the qualities, bad and good, either from the teacher or from the mother and father. So the present generation is day by day is degrading, downgrading, degenerating. Why? Because there is no idealistic person, no changed person. So there is a reason why this media, literature, and the Ravan rupee isku jo, it has been expanded in this world so much, there is no way for them to show the right part or right knowledge. That's how the world is degrading, downgrading, and facing several problems all over the globe. So with this, I thank you, the organizers. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you very much, Honorable Mr. Justice V. Aishwarya. He has stated that to have the better world, we must have idealistic persons and the aim and objects of the Constitution, and even the ideas given by the knowledge given by our scripts is very vast, but in a nutshell, the knowledge given by these institutions really gives us the idea how we can have the better world.